legs will hit your hip. If your bulletin, there are some songs. This one just happens to be entitled Abide in Me. We invite you to stand on your feet and sing with us. If you don't feel like standing up, you don't have to do this. Service today, Father, and would you just open the ears that need to be opened, open the hearts that need to be touched, Father, and just be here with us. We are so humbled by your presence today, Father. One of the most beautiful places I've ever seen. We get to hang out with you today. What a joy and blessing that is, Father. We love you, and we are so grateful. In your precious name we pray. Amen. One of my favorite songs in the hymnal. It's called Old Rugged Cross.
Yeah. Over here, by the way, stood an old rugged cross. The end of suffering and shame. Yeah.
How you doing, brother?
Amen. All right, people, I have an announcement to make. Tomorrow is Max Stevens, my husband's last chemo.
Yeah, praise God.
Y'all are my grace, my claim. That applause will get me through the next 3 weeks. And I cannot thank you enough for supporting us. So we continue because it's, as y'all know, not over yet. I love y'all. I love you.
Your faith, right? Relationships in your day-to-day. But one thing that I can say for certain is that right now, in this place that you're in, you are surrounded by people who love God. You are surrounded by people who love you. And I just encourage right now for you to find that place of worship in your own time. Don't worry about the person next to you or who's behind you. Who's gonna think you can't sing very good because you're belting out? Because I'll tell you what, Jesus doesn't care. So I encourage you, if you want to stand and sing and praise, then do that. And if your place is to sit and close your eyes and just enjoy Him for a little while, I encourage you to do that as well.
And thank you to all of you who are here worshiping with us at Worship at the Water. I am not Jeremy Mount, in case you didn't notice. I'm Robin Wilson, and I'm a friend of Jeremy's, and a fan of Jeremy's as well. And it's been my honor to beg Jeremy for the invitation to get to preach and to share the Word of God with all of you. I must tell you, I've been to the Flora-Bama before, but not like this. And before my preacher days, and Jeremy said, you might not want to open with your stories from then, so I won't do that to you. But I have to tell you, I'm one of the pastors at Dolphin Way United Methodist Church in Mobile, and there's several Dolphin Way members who are here today. I hope that you've mailed your checks to Dolphin Way. Appreciate that. And I'm so honored to be able to be with each of you who is here because you want to experience the Word of God. You want to experience the holiness of worship, and you have found a home in this wonderful place. So let's have a word of prayer together. Almighty God, we thank you so much that you call us here. You call us from the rest of our lives to be still, to sit among your people, and to put you first. Help us to do that not only as we hear and experience your word today, but also as we leave this place different because we have met you here through your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
You'll notice in your bulletin you've got the scripture printed for you. The scripture I'm preaching from today is from 1 Corinthians chapter 15. And let me tell you a little bit about this situation. The Apostle Paul, whose mission it was to take the Word of God into the world, to take it to people who didn't know the love of Christ. He is writing to this church in Corinth. Now, Corinth is a town on the sea, has lots of people who come and go. It's known for a little bit of sin, known for a little bit of debauchery, known for having a whole lot of people who like to have a good time. But he's writing to these people in Corinth who see life differently, who want to live differently because of the love of Christ in their lives, and they are trying to get together in the midst of everything else in the world around them in this little bitty town on the sea and be the people of God. So Paul writes to them to tell them a couple of things about what it means to be God's people, what it means to live what they believe. So let's hear God's word together. You may join me in following along. Paul writes, now let me ask you something profound yet troubling. If you became believers because you trusted the proclamation that Christ is alive, risen from the dead, how can you let people say that there is no such thing as a resurrection? If there's no resurrection, there's no living Christ. And face it, if there's no resurrection for Christ, everything we've told you is smoke and mirrors. And everything you've staked your life on is smoke and mirrors. Not only that, but we would be guilty of telling a string of barefaced lies about God. All these affidavits we passed on to you, verifying that God raised up Christ. Sheer fabrications if there's no resurrection. If corpses can't be raised, then Christ wasn't, because he was indeed dead. And if Christ were not raised, then all you're doing is wandering around in the dark, as lost as ever. It's even worse for those who died hoping in Christ and resurrection, because they're already in their graves. If all we get out of Christ is a little inspiration for a few short years, we're a pretty sorry lot. But the truth is that Christ has been raised up, the first in a long legacy of those who are going to leave the cemeteries. There's a nice symmetry in this. Death initially came by a man, and resurrection from death came by a man. Everybody dies in Adam. Everyone comes alive in Christ. But we have to wait our turn. Christ is first, then those with him at his coming. The grand consummation when, after crushing the opposition, He hands over his kingdom to God the Father. He won't let up until the last enemy is down and the very last enemy is death. As the psalmist said, he laid them low, one and all. He walked all over them. When the scripture says that he walked all over them, it's obvious that he couldn't at the same time be walked on. When everything and everyone is finally under God's rule, the sun will step down, taking his place with everyone else, showing that God's rule is absolutely comprehensive, a perfect ending. Now, I like the Apostle Paul, and I like that we can now use these as fans now that I've finished reading. A whole lot of words to get across a couple of major points. Paul is telling the people of Corinth two things. Now, these people in this seaport town, these people living and worshiping on the water, are worried about two things. They believe in God, but they don't believe in the resurrection of Christ, and they don't believe in the resurrection of the dead. And they're having trouble with that. And so Paul writes them and says, you people, you have missed the boat. If you are organizing yourselves as a church, if you are trying to be good people, but you don't have faith in this, then you are of all people most to be pitied. Why in the world are you organizing yourselves in a way that means that there's no hope for the future? I like Paul. Paul reminds me of my dad, because I think Paul says, you people, don't be stupid. My father used to always say, don't do dumb things. Don't do dumb things. And I think that's what Paul is saying. Now, my dad and I used to like to watch movies and take an afternoon nap on Sunday afternoon. I think that's what Sunday afternoon stood for. And one of my favorite movies that I ever watched with my dad on Sunday afternoon was a movie called City Slickers. Do y'all remember that? With Billy Crystal? Billy Crystal and Jack Palance, and they've gone on this trip. Billy Crystal has kind of lost his zest for life. He doesn't remember why he's doing what he's doing. He's bored with his family, he's bored with his friends, and he's lost his get up and go, his reason for being. And he thinks he's going to find it again on a cattle trail, riding the range out west. And so Mitch, Billy Crystal's character, meets up with Curly. Now Curly's played by Jack Palance. He's cool, he's together, he seems secure and happy with who he is. Now, the two strike up an odd friendship, and one day they're riding herd and cattle together. And Curly looks over at Mitch, who's still kind of agitated, is not happy with life. And he says to Mitch, Mitch, I'm going to let you in on a little secret. The secret of life. Well, that's what Mitch has been wanting to hear. And so he says, well, that's great, Curly. Quick, tell me what it is. And he tips his hat back, as good cowboys do. And he says, it's this. Well, Curly, that's just wonderful. Thanks for telling me. Now, quick, tell me, what is this? And Curly says, ah, that's what you have to figure out. This. Well, thank goodness we know as Christians what this is. The reason we exist, the reason we live, is this, that Jesus Christ came, died, and rose again to save us from sin and death. Right? We get it. We're smart. We're here. We're worshiping. So why did these people in Corinth not get it? Why did they try to be good people who like Jesus, but not get what their main thing is? And so I'm sitting there thinking, I've studied the Bible, I've been around. I don't know why the people of Corinth would organize themselves, try to be a church, do these things and worship and not know why. I don't know anybody who doesn't live like the resurrection is the most important thing, that Jesus Christ came and he died and he rose. And then I think how often I am in a Corinthian. How often I, and maybe we all, can sit and wallow in our own sin. We live with the burdens of what we've done and what we haven't done. We live in a way that just feeds on our own guilt of our own existence and our own past. And we forget to live every day as if Jesus Christ really matters. As if the resurrection actually means something to us. And we forget to live in the freedom and the power that God gives us. We forget to live that joyful faith of that free gift that is ours to share with the world and share in our lives and share in our joy. How often we are too Corinthians. We get it. You know, I had a teacher one time who challenged us at the beginning of each class he taught with these words. What would it mean for us to live every day as if Jesus Christ really mattered? As if he really mattered to you, to the world, and to this life. What would it mean? How would that change the way that we spend our money and we spend our time? How does that change the way that we help the poor? How does that change the way we treat our family, the people we're stuck with in this life? How does it change us if we live every day this resurrection faith? We live every day as if Jesus Christ really mattered and really matters to you. And so, from my own Corinthian ways, from our own admission that we want to be a resurrection people, it's my privilege and the power that is given to me by the Holy Spirit to come to you today and to proclaim freedom and hope and help from everything that this life and this world can throw at you. We have freedom to live differently than the way that we have lived before. We have freedom to overcome through Christ sin that has invaded our lives, that has become habits that we are comfortable with. We have hope for the future, for tomorrow. Because this resurrection is not only of Christ, it is ours as well. And we get to live forever in glory with him. And we have help because we don't just have to change on our own. We have the power of Jesus Christ to bring us forward, to help us, to change us, to live better and live differently, to change our communities, our families, our lives, and our world. And thanks be to God for that.
Amen.
Now stop all that. I have to tell you, there's this wonderful story about the painting of the Last Supper. This is before the Da Vinci Codes or anything like that, but it's one of my favorites. I want you to hear it and hear yourself in it as well. But apparently, Leonardo da Vinci was painting this magnificent fresco, this painting on the side of a wall of Jesus and the disciples having the Last Supper. And he worked on it, and he got the colors just right, and he called a friend of his who was also an artist in to come and see it. And his friend came in and looked, I imagine as artists do, and he said, at long last, it's magnificent. I can feel the atmosphere of the room. I feel like I'm there with you. I can almost smell the dinner. I can feel the tension in the room. It's magnificent, but I cannot take my eyes off of this magnificent golden chalice, which is in the center. I can see the gold gleaming off of it, and I can almost reach out and feel the encrusted jewels on the side. It's amazing. And the story goes that then Da Vinci dismissed his friend, picked up his paintbrush, and with bold strokes painted over that chalice and replaced it with a simple gray cup off to the side. He invited his friend to come back and to view the painting on the wall once more. And his friend was aghast and said, "How could you do that? How could you mess up a thing of beauty? It was the most magnificent thing I've ever seen in art. How could you destroy such a thing?" And the story goes that Da Vinci replied, "Because nothing should take us away from our focus. And in this painting, Christ is the focus."
Amen.
Perhaps Da Vinci hit on something there that his artist friend and the people of that seaside church in Corinth so long ago, you and I today as well need to remember. There are things that might take away our focus that look good and sparkly and appealing. They look like things of beauty, but nothing should take us away from our focus. The joy and the hope that we have together in Christ Jesus our Lord, who died and rose again to save us from sin and death, and with whom we will share in that resurrection story in the life to come. So maybe Da Vinci reminds us all of our main thing. Would you pray with me? Almighty God, we are humbled today because we know that we are not the people that we should be for you. We are people who are distracted by our own agendas, our own habits and desires, the places that we have found comfort in life that are not honoring you. We come to you, Almighty God, because we know that we want to be people who live what it is that we believe. We live that resurrection hope every day. But we know, Almighty God, that we so often are Corinthians. Forgive us for that. But don't just stop there, because that's too easy for us, Almighty God. Transform us by the power of your Spirit, that we might live every day as if Jesus really matters. Help us, guide us, direct us, inspire us, and fill us with your hope so that we might make you our main thing. Amen.
Amen.
As is our custom here at Worship in the Water, we invite you to a time of prayer. This may feel strange for some of you. This is your first time here. But what we like to do is pray with someone near you. Talk to them about the things that you want to lift up to God. Talk to them. Pray with each other. And let us be people of resurrection faith together. Let's do that while we're led in worship.
Amazing grace, sweet the sound. Close down the door.
Oh, black woman, will the stop is over.